Okay, we're going to be talking about inverse functions here, and this video is intended to dovetail off of Dr. Fowler's video, What is a Function? And in that video, you saw that a function was basically a relationship between two quantities, trying to predict one quantity from another, in which for every x, for every element of the domain, there is exactly one y, one element in the range that corresponds to it, or that is assigned to it. Good physical example, very typical physical example, is throwing a ball up in the air and trying to relate, can we predict the height of the ball at any particular time? And we can see a graph of this function. All functions can be represented with a graph a lot of times, and often with a formula as well. Sometimes not with a formula, but we can get a good idea for what it's intended to be. Now, the key thing here is height, is that a function of time? And the answer is yes, and the basic answer is a physical answer. For any particular time here, that's the domain, there's only going to be one height that ball can be at. The ball can only be at one place at one time. So that is going to be a function here. Another way to say that is this graph passes the vertical line test, for example. Okay, so we clearly have that height is a function of time here. The question we're going to be studying here today is time. Is that going to be some function of the height? And the answer to that is no. If we go the other way here and we say, let's look at this height and we ask, at what time, one specific time here, at that ball was at that height, we don't know which one to pick because there are two different times when that ball is at that height, this time and about this time. So we have a little bit of a problem here in defining time as a function of height, at least as it's drawn here. That does not change the fact that height is a function of time. We still have it the other way here. And also the physical problem certainly makes sense. All right, we can only be at one height at any particular time, but it also makes sense that there could be a couple of different times for a particular height. So let's study here a little bit more deeply what a graph has to be for an inverse function to exist, and going backwards here. In other words, instead of trying to use the time here to predict the height, we want to use the height to predict the time. So let's look at another example here, and this one with a formula and a graph here. It will be another parabola. We're going to be looking at the function f of x, or y if you will, is equal to x minus 5 quantity squared plus 3. And you might recall that this is a parabola. This function is a parabola, and it has vertex, and this is very unscaled here, and it has vertex the point 5, 3. And we can see here we have the same problem here. We can certainly, given one x here, we can always predict one y, but given one y, well, there's two x's here that correspond to it here. So we don't have that x is a function of y, we do have that y is a function of x. So what do we do? Well, the big problem here is what happens when we have this situation where we have two outputs for the given input of y. Well, what's going on here is that the graph has basically turned around to go in the opposite direction and therefore return to a point that it was already at. So what we need here for a function to have an inverse, for an inverse to exist or to define an inverse function here, is the graph must always be either always increasing or always decreasing here. Let's just look at the increasing function here. And you can see for any y here, there is only going to be one x here because the graph doesn't double back on itself and come back, say, to make a new x here. And so for what we call f inverse of x to exist, f of x itself must be always increasing or decreasing. Well, how does that help us in terms of having any hope of finding an inverse function for our favorite parabola here? Well, basically what we're going to do, and this is the trick you're going to see, especially with inverse trig functions, you're going to see this trick. Obviously, trig functions like sine and cosine blatantly fail the horizontal line test. The horizontal line test, of course, meaning that starting at a y, if you go over, it's only going to hit the graph once, which is basically saying it's a function of y there, basically. So what we do here is we say, well, let's restrict our function that we have here and only talk about that part of the function where it's only always increasing or a part that's always decreasing. What we want to make sure is that when we do so, that we're going to cover as much y as possible here, the maximal domain, so to speak, here. And we want to cover as much y values that we can, actually maximal range here in this case. And so we're going to make sure that we pick something that's going to go from, we want to restrict, say, our x's to go from 5 to the right there. So x would be greater than or equal to 5. We very well could have picked x less than or equal to 5 to be our restricted domain as well. But in any case here, that's the trick to making an inverse function, is if it's not already increasing and decreasing all the time, restrict it to a domain where it always is. And so in this case here, we're only going to be considering or caring about our function for x values greater than or equal to 5. So how do we do this with a formula here? Here is our formula for y is equal to x minus 5 quantity squared plus 3, and we're restricting this for only x values greater than or equal to 5. So that will guarantee always increasing in this case, and it will catch all the y values that we care about. Well, again, this is a function of x as it's written here. If we plugged in a value of x, we'd be able to predict out what is the value of y by just plugging and chugging and cranking out the arithmetic. We want to ask the other way, of course, here. Is given any y value here, can we predict what x has to be? In other words, say y was equal to 7, can we predict what x would be here? And as you can see, that's going to involve some algebra, some undoing, basically, to find the x that makes that true, if one exists. And then when we're done, of course, we only want to pick x's that are bigger than or equal to 5. Let's actually go through this here and crank this out. So what we get here is we're going to solve for x, and so kind of our what we're trying to hunt for here is kind of imprisoned here in this parentheses and the square and the plus 3 here. So we're going to kind of unwrap the birthday present, so to speak, and we've wrapped up x in a birthday present by subtracting 5 from it there, squaring the result and adding 3. So we're going to unwrap the birthday present in the opposite order. So the last thing we did here was add 3, so to subtract 3 from both sides. Then the next to last thing we did was square, so how do we undo the square? Well, we're going to take the square root, and of course when you do that, one of the awful things about having a square root is you get two selections for an answer. That's why the square as it is does not have an inverse function. Then what we're going to do then, the square does not go there. Then finally here what we did was we subtracted 5 from our x, so to unwrap that birthday present, we're going to add 5 to both sides. We get x here is 5 plus or minus 2. Well, we get two answers as predicted here. As we saw with our graph, we get two y's, that, or two x's here that correspond to the y equal to 7. Which one do we pick? Well, we can either pick x equal to 7 or x equal to 3. But if you recall here by our restriction here, we only cared about x bigger than or equal to 5 to restrict here, so we're only going to be able to pick, or only care to pick here, the one on the right for when y is equal to 7. All right, so we're only going to pick this one here, and that happens to be x is equal to 7 in this particular case. So it turns out 7 played two different roles here, unfortunately, in this problem. So we're going to pick x equal to 7 to be our answer. And then, depending on the function you have to do, you're going to have to fight to find other values of x that make that true. For example, with a trig function, if you're trying to find the angle that makes that true, you'll have to add, say, 2 pi, or go by the quadrants there to find the other angles that might make that statement true. But what about in general here? How can we find here, given any generic y, instead of y equal to 7, given any generic y here, value here, can we find x as a function then of y? So let's do that. And what we're going to do is just follow the same arithmetic we did before in solving for x. So we would first subtract 3. Y is our given value there. And then we want to take the square root to undo the square. And once again, we run into that plus or minus situation here. And as we saw before, we wanted to pick the positive one here. That was the one that gave us the x bigger than or equal to 5 that we cared about here. And then finally here to solve for x, we add 5. So the very same arithmetic that we did before, we get this here. And so we see here that x now is some sort of function of y. And if you can look there, because the plus and minus isn't in here, if you pick any y, as long as it's bigger or equal to 3, that makes sense because we wanted our y's to be above the vertex, or at the vertex or above. The corresponding x value then, we would just plug in the y here, and we would get exactly one y value out because we would not be getting anything on that left-hand side of the graph. Always remember to label these axes. However, what we like to do here when we write a function here is we typically like that to be a function of x rather than y. So what we do is we switch the roles of x and y, and what you'll see there in your Fable textbook then is you'll see y then is going to be some f inverse of x. This basically just says this is the undoing process here that you would do, and you would be writing this here as 5 plus the square root of x minus 3 here. And what you'll see here is the x you'll be plugging in, which used to be called the y a second ago here, will be greater than or equal to 3. So because we switched the x's and the y's there, that then will give us here, when we had y is equal to f of x before, which was our original function. So for example, if we plugged in, say, 21 into this function here, so when we plug in the, so for f, if we were looking at the graph of f, we plugged in x equal to 21, we would get 21 minus 5 quantity squared, and so this would be 16 squared here, which is 256 plus 3, and that gives us 259. However, if we plug in f inverse here, and now we're going to be plugging in the 259 now, which is now called x because that's the notation we want to work with there. So if we plug in 259 into the undoing function here, let's see what happens. We get 259 minus 3 is 256. Square root that, that gives us 16. And add 5 there, that gives us back our 21. So we get here, at least in this numerical example, the idea that if xy is on the graph of f, then the reverse here, values here, say x1 and y1 here, we would get y1, x1 would be on the graph of f inverse. And that is our end of our presentation then on inverse functions.